Ireland Overall Inc. is doing extremely well. Although the rate of growth is maybe softening somewhat, not least because we're seeing the largest local market is shrinking, possibly even at an acceleration rate. And we see that in even last week's CSO figures. And of course, you don't need to tell me that this growth has been very inequitable in terms of distribution regionally, obviously, to the point that we have capacity issues and peak congestion with accommodation, as you keep reminding me. And even, but also at attractions at certain locations and so on. But also, as I often have to remind you, there's also an awful lot of availability and volume in other, at other times and in other locations. But if you really want a cold shower and you want to drill down and see where Brexit really is impacting, ironically, the strongest performing tourism areas have least UK dependency and therefore no major concerns. But the poorest performing areas that have the highest dependency and face the greatest challenges in diversifying, and I'm speaking in particular, as Paul has already said, about border towns and Midlands, where the potential for growth in overseas revenues and numbers are significantly challenged. But let me give you some examples or illustrate the point with some Port Ireland 2015 statistics. 16% of overseas visitors in Kerry are from the UK. 80% in Clare, 19% in Kilkenny. But when you go up to northern part of the Longford and Leitrim, 63% of the overseas visitors there are from the UK. Monaghan is 65%. Down Wexford, I suppose, obviously, but same with the ferries and so on, you have a high dependency there. And furthermore, and I think it's very important, really important, the UK visitors, while they're not the highest yielding, but they have the broadest and deepest regional and rural penetration, benefiting every parish and village and town in the country, where maybe very often our traditional transatlantic and continental visitors don't go. And also, critically, they have the broadest seasonal distribution, is in areas at low and off-peak times, obviously for many of our BFRs and friends and relatives, but also given close proximity and the easy, multiple, cheap, convenient access options for city and short activity breaks and so on. So in relative terms, the proportion of personal income from tourism in these underdeveloped areas and high rated exposure areas is often actually higher than in traditional or established tourism regions, because quite simply tourism is the only show in town. And let there be no doubt, Brexit is here, arrived firmly and is now manifesting itself. The current seekers of advantage from Brexit was cushioned to an extent in the early months, because many UK visitors had actually pre-booked and probably prepaid for their visitors prior to the referendum. And of course, a lot of the wholesale business and tour operators were probably hedged as well. Now, however, we're out in open seas and uncharted waters, no cushions now. And the numbers and revenues are indeed impacted. And it also, the rate of decline is increased. And while the UK, the decline in UK visitors is worrying at national levels, many regions are seeing an even more pronounced fall off in visitors. You know, historically, things like foot and mouth, like ash and SARS, terrorism, things, they're all very finite and tangible events. You know, and after a certain number of weeks, it's supposed to set up the usual. On. The Brexit is very much more difficult to comprehend. But now, sentiment, confidence, UK visitor numbers and revenues, stay durations are all in decline and the impact is indeed tangible, albeit we don't know where or how it's going to end up. So there's a lot of uncertainty out there. You know, there are three pillars of sustainable tourism. You know, tourism needs to be environmentally, socially and financially viable. Now, you can still get on with tourism even if it's not working environmentally or socially, you know, it might be not ethical. But if it's not working financially, businesses will fail, jobs will be lost, and that's the reality. And that's a real threat in areas of high regulatory exposure, particularly given the existing regional and seasonal dependence. So a quick tour, how has Brexit manifested itself out there on the ground? Obviously retail, you know, the regional towns and border towns, Kenny, Skye, and Malin, and all the way around, they're actually seeing a big decline already in cross-border shopping, and obviously there's going to be a bumper Christmas going north, and that's already shaping up. Border hoteliers on the southern side reporting significant downturn in the wedding business. You know, wedding receptions, lower attendance, lower yields, lower spend. Also, a significant drop can be seen now in when it goes to King's Fly Drive, UK visitors, and top groups. Coach tours probably go with lower load factors. On seaside resorts, you know, Donegal, Sligo, Mayo, that both of them seen very noticeable decline in UK visitors to Northern Ireland. You see it in the golf clubs and the supermarkets and fast food and so on. And so on, one more, one more, all those sort of places. Although people there seem to be reasonably happy because I think a lot of the business is able to decline is probably masked by maybe a bit of buoyancy in the domestic scene and so on. But it is really there. Briefly on short break leisure, on the domestic front in Ireland, 2 nights have been page 2 of the Independent, that sort of thing. That's a very significant part in both border and midland counties and so on. And a lot of northern people would be coming down on that. So now we're disadvantaged there because we're a lot more expensive. And just on that note, do you think someone could spend a couple of hours on a border crossing through security and border control and come down just for a weekend and later? I think not. But not only that, a lot of those people that were coming from north down are not. But because the north is that more attractive, we've got people from the south going north, and I see how it gets me smiling that front. So when you take the full swing of that pendulum, it's quite significant. And even just to compound that, there's a lot of new capacity coming on stream in Belfast. Belfast is doing extremely well, but they'll be quite challenged to maintain their occupancy levels because of the increased capacity. So it's possible that rates will even fall further, and that will drive more traffic from the south up to north, which is coming out of the southern sharpest measure market. UK coarse angling markets, you know, working class, Midlands, North England, that would be in the Shannon area, that sort of stuff, that certainly was in decline, but certainly very, very much more, very price sensitive and so on, that very much in decline. UK crews are higher, Emirates Ireland would say, yeah, they're seeing a big decline there, but more compensated for by continental business. Central Parks Longford, they are revising the projections and their forecasting and so on for the early years and so on. Their actual capital cost has gone up about 35 million just because of the currency, although they were still very committed to the project. Moving on then, north of the border, I've already talked about more northward migration and shopping and so on. Belfast International Airport reporting a phenomenal increase in southern people losing the airport over 200%. Clarence Hurst, they probably one of the car dealerships in Northern Ireland, reporting on 20% of new cars are coming south. Howard Hastings was talking about two tourists. People that are going to be going to Eastern Europe for extensive treatment, but not going north because it's cheaper, it's more accessible, more language, more confidence, more interest, and all that sort of stuff. The drinks industry commissioned a comment that panels by Anthony Foley, and he reported about a 68 million loss in this year to the pub sector, which probably makes ITIC's estimate of 100 million in tourism loss this year to very conservative. Not the airport actually is bucking the trend. Here for 83% of the visitors arriving on the airport airport from the UK, but they're actually reporting at the end of August a 4% increase in passenger numbers and a 7% increase in load factor. Obviously a very high VFR dependency there and so on. And just one loss of the 9 UK services that were lost, the automatic decrease there being into that in the numbers as well. Just speaking on that Shannon Lakeland, Midlands, Heartland, that's fourth iconic brand that I have the two calls head direct about and so on. It is not noteworthy that the geographic area of that brand proposition on the development is very heavily UK dependent and Brexit vulnerable. And I wonder, would or should the brand developer be Brexit conscious in that context? So that's a sort of a whistle stop snapshot from the ground. And aside from story enough, it really doesn't make good reading. And of course, that's the reason why we're here this morning. So in relation to this morning's business, I warmly welcome the initiative on Forge Ireland. Compliment that and those of my given to Tours of Ireland, which I will be another bit of litigation from the UK shortly. The strand and strategy approach, I think it's very appropriate in its approach, its timing, its content, its structure. I'm not going to go through all the pillars again. You've heard it a number of times, so I'm going to skip through all of that. But I think it is encouraging to know that there will be flexed tweaks and so on as it evolves and as new issues arise, which inevitably will happen. But alongside those four strands, I think there's two other dimensions that we need to be conscious of. And it's already been mentioned, but I need to say it again, that is competitiveness. You know, it's imperative we keep our value for money proposition. You know, against our currency disadvantage, we simply can't take our foot off the pedal in that context. And it would be remiss of me not to mention the realigned VAT rate. and with potential zero rate airport tax, and to emphasise the importance of retaining these very successful initiatives. And hospitality providers also must be responsible in their pricing strategy and take the long term sensible approach at the expense of the short term potential gain. And I suppose that the final dimension I would bring to it is about innovation, and we really have to be thinking out of the box. You know, the arguments support a major increase in investment in tourism product, but realistically, of the foreseeable future, you know, we're only really going to get modest increments to our annual marketing spend, you know, other than ad hoc initiatives such as this one and the core brand proposition. But in any event, you know, Brexit exposed areas have capacity, loads of capacity, they have the products, the availability, the infrastructure and people. So we need to be clever and resourceful. You know, slow tourism is a very, there are huge opportunities there and probably a very good fit in that core proposition. Likewise, blue ways and green ways, which give, you know, quite a lot of product at relatively low cost, and what was Ireland would be support on that area, and particularly in areas with a high Brexit exposure and trade dependency. And of course, Dublin's difficulty. Dublin has already been alluded to, there is a capacity issue in Dublin, albeit of a short term nature, but Dublin's difficulty is Ireland's opportunity. You know, there are, as I've already said, some of the program or itinerary planners for coach tours and so on are rescheduling their routes and so on. And you know, there really are opportunities, and we should be really engaging with those people for mutual benefit. You know, there are some that are using maybe Midland towns as hubs and actually doing Dublin and the West Coast from a central location in the middle of Ireland. Another interesting one is we have a pilot scheme in discussion with the Diageo, where all funny innovative but clever people out of the box, where we tour operators arrive and tell the audience to begin this day, begin this and arrive, and just to set the mood going, and that's just a bit innovative and thinking outside the box. Martinez Brown Bread, small innovative enhancements, you know, that really give us the competitive edge. There's for things we've got. You know, the tourism challenges of Brexit are indeed immense, but you know, so also is the around the expertise and the determination of the stakeholders in this room, and indeed the industry out there we are working. So together I am confident that we can mitigate the negative impacts and maximise the positive opportunities that arise.